took away what I was going to say this morning. I was going to ask you guys, what was the first word that came into your mind when I said Ebenezer? And so you know what we're speaking about now anyway. So nobody's going to say Ebenezer Scrooge because we know what we're going to speak about. Well, when he was giving me this information, the first thing that came to my mind was Ebenezer Scrooge. So as I'm very intently listening to him, or look like I'm listening to him, my brain is over here going, Ebenezer Scrooge? I'm talking about Ebenezer Scrooge. Is he even in the Bible? No, wait a minute. That's Charles Dickens. He's not in the Bible. So it was, Dale, I have to apologize. I heard about three words of the whole speech you told me. I heard Ebenezer, I heard Samuel, and I heard talk. So I went home and took my mighty Google app out, and I Googled Ebenezer. All right, so what do you think is the first thing that came up? Come on. It was not. It was 1 Samuel 7. And I was like, because now I know what, you know, where it was, because I didn't even remember where it was in Samuel, so we did a happy thing. Anyway, so I want to start you off with verses 9. Do you have it up there? Okay. I've got it here too. Hold on. All right. Verses 9. Then Samuel took a suckling lamb and sacrificed it as a whole burnt offering to the Lord. He cried out to the Lord on Israel's behalf, and the Lord answered him. While Samuel was sacrificing the burnt offering, the Philistines drew near to engage Israel in battle. But that day the Lord thundered with loud thunder against the Philistines and threw them into such a panic that they were routed before the Israelites. The men of Israel rushed out of Mizpah and pursued the Philistines, slaughtering them along the way to a point below Beth Kar. Then Samuel took a stone and set it up between Mizpah and Shen. He named it Ebenezer, saying, "Thus far the Lord has helped us." Now, the Israelites and the Philistines were always, I'm going to call them Phillies because it's so much easier. Hopefully I don't offend anybody. Okay, no, but it's a Philly fan, I know. All right, I'm going to call them Phillies, all right. But they're always, it seems to me that they were at war a lot, okay? I did a little research on them, and they had advanced weaponry. Their military force was greater. They were known as a violent, warlike people. There were two previous battles in the same site that they were about to do battle on, and the Phillies had defeated the Israelites completely. Now, they were definitely the underdogs in this battle. They had absolutely no hope of defeating this enemy on their own strength. So they acknowledged their sin, they returned to their faithful God, and they won this battle. So Samuel set up an Ebenezer, which means the stone of help. Now, as I read and I reread these verses, okay, one word kept popping up in my head, faithfulness. Faithfulness is one of God's inherent characteristics. It's part of his nature. It's part of who he is. He cannot be unfaithful. He cannot do it. Just like he can't lie, he cannot do it. So here are some synonyms for faithful. He is loyal. He is constant. I can't stand still. I'm sorry. He is loyal. He is constant. He is true. He is unswerving. He is committed. He is staunch, trustworthy, dependable, reliable, steadfast, dedicated, devoted. Did you get those last two? He is dedicated to us. He is devoted to us. Now, I'm going to take you back a few books to Genesis 3. So you can see how God is devoted to us. Okay? Got that one up? Yeah. Okay. Then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man, "Where are you?" So Eve had listened to the lies of Satan. You guys know the story. She took the bite out of the one fruit that was specifically told not to take the bite off. Hundreds of beautiful, life-producing trees in this garden, and she had to have the one she could have. And I don't think I would have been any different. I probably would have been there, and I would have said, "Eve, sure, it's Karen, please give me a bite of that fruit," because that's the way we are. So, now, is it possible that the God of all creation, the God that formed them, the God that formed this universe, the God that formed the heavens, the earth, that made everything that they were witness to? Is it possible that he didn't know where Adam and Eve were? He's omniscient. He knows everything. Is it possible he didn't know where they were? Is it, you know, possible that maybe he was looking under rocks, behind waterfalls? Maybe he was going, uh-oh, I think I lost the children. What am I going to tell the parents? Oh, wait, I am the parent. Uh-oh. So he knew exactly where they were. As soon as Eve took that fateful bite of that fruit, that life-giving relationship that tethered the Creator and the creation was severed. It was broken. It was no more. I can just imagine our God saying, Eve, what have you done? What have you done? Yet still knowing what they had done, He calls to them, where are you? There were definitely consequences to their disobedience, but he still comes to them. He comes to them walking, strolling, calmly in the cool of the day. Where are you? You broke my one and only command. One and only command. And I am still looking for you. I am still devoted to you. So since the beginning of time, he calls to us. This is back in Genesis. The beginning of time, he's been calling to us. Where are you? All through the pages of that love letter we call the Bible, he calls to us. He is so devoted, so faithful to us, that he let his only son be mutilated beyond recognition. He lets iron spikes, 5 inches long, that's what I read. Who knows what the real size was. Maybe some theologian knows. But he let these iron spikes go through the limbs of his only son because he is faithfulness for us and his devotion for us. So no matter what we go through, no matter what battles we fight, are fighting, will fight, have fought, no matter what this crazy planet throws at us, we have a God who is in control of it all, whose persistent, unwavering faithfulness and devotion for us, even when we don't deserve it, will never, ever, ever end for us. Our amazing, faithful God, he's our Ebenezer. He is our stone of help, and he will help us every step of the way. Jeremiah summed it up beautifully in Lamentations 3, 21 through 23. Yet this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed. We're not destroyed. We're not eaten up. We're not devoured. His compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. So please turn to hymn 48.
Thank you. right. Thanks, John.
Hello. Hi, Brad. Dale also said anything that God puts on our hearts for a fair game, so I want to show pictures of our grandkids, if that's all right. Someday he too would choose the power of Christ. that verse from Because He Lives kind of stood out to me as one of God's promises. He gave me real peace through it. It's one we quite often don't say when we sing Because He Lives. But it says, how sweet to hold a newborn baby, to feel the pride and the joy he gives. But sweeter still, the strong assurance this child can face on certain days because Christ lives. I realized that my confidence wasn't in me and my ability to be a dad. My confidence was in God and his ability to look out for and to protect and guide this child through life and bring him to relationship with him. Yes, I had been given a huge responsibility to raise and nurture this child. Proverbs 22:6 says, train up a child in the way he should go, and even when he is old, he will not depart from it. That's been another one of God's promises that stood out to me. What does it mean to train up a child in the way he should go? And my Bible notes, it says, this proverb was founded on the covenant that God made with Abraham. So looking back to Genesis 18 and 19, shall surely become a great and mighty nation, and all the nations of the earth shall be blessed in him. For I have chosen him, that he may command his children and his household after him to keep the way of the Lord by doing righteousness and justice, so that the Lord may bring to Abraham what he has promised him. Train up a child. Train up a child encourages parents to dedicate or to initiate their children in the way. That's the way you should go. The right moral orientation by pointing to the kinds of conduct that please or displease the Lord, and to the normal outcome of each kind of conduct and the consequences that go with it. The training will include love and instruction, as well as the proper discipline. I do that one. We've been blessed to see both our kids choose to follow Jesus as our Lord and Savior. We've been blessed to see both our kids marry spouses who love the Lord, and together are training their children in the way they should go also. Some may say a six-year-old isn't old enough to be baptized. Maybe their thought process hasn't developed enough to fully know what they're doing. And I remember a pastor who didn't want to serve communion to children because he thought they need to reach a certain age of accountability, I guess. But I believe it's important to be concerned, and we shouldn't take lightly when we do these things. But we should know the meaning and why we're doing it. If we could just put that picture of Nicole back up again, I don't know if we... It's a video, so it's tough, but I just want you to see the joy that's in her eyes as she jumps into her father's arms, and she knows what she's doing. Obviously, her mom had taken the time to explain that we have trouble getting that. That's okay. She just turned 7. She was 6, okay. Levi, Nicole's brother, who was three, and hearing him all the talk about Nicole, how proud we were of her. So when I invite Jesus into my heart, I'm going to give God a great big hug. So Liam, who's Bethany's oldest, and he's two, he's progressed from the why stage to what happens if stage. So one says his mom was trying to reason with him. He said, but I want to make bad choices. She says she's looking for the day when he chooses Jesus rather than bad choices. So Roman, who's the youngest, is almost 3 months. He's eating, sleeping, pooping, gooping, smiling, lifting his head up to change and check things out. So, in closing, I want to applaud you mom and dads who are training your child, training and raising your children in the way they should go. As a church, we want to be encouraging and help you along the way. Maybe you say, yeah, we did the best we can, and our kids aren't following the Lord. Keep praying. Be the example of holiness in front of them and see what God will do. By the way, did I mention my grandkids?
Okay, so we're going to sing number 426, Tell Me the Story of Jesus. We're going to do one and three. By the time I turned 30, which was in a few weeks.
I can also recall that anytime someone asked me what my biggest fear was, it was not being able to have my own children. So, fast forward a few years into marriage, we still didn't have any kids, and began seeking answers as to why it wasn't happening. We were still waiting for our biggest dream to come true. And I sat wondering if I'll ever be a mom. What I want to share today is how God has walked with me through this incredibly hard and roller coaster journey. But how he's transformed me from fearing a life without kids to fearing a life without him. I knew I was going to cry.
It's all right.
So, one of my favorite verses that I've come to know through this struggle and still hold dear comes from Psalms chapter 62. Verses 1 and 2. It says, I wait quietly before God, for my victory comes from him. He alone is my rock and my salvation, my fortress where I will never be shaken. That verse just gives such hope, and it shows God's faithfulness and his strength. So as I was thinking about what I wanted to share today, I came across a few acronyms for waiting that I kind of combined together to paint a picture of how I'm learning to wait well while God is working. Worship through it. Ask God about his purposes. Invest in preparation. And trust God to fulfill his plans and promises. Now, this may not be what you expect, but worshiping God through my pain and my infertility struggles has been the easiest part of my wait. Whether it's been through music, through praise, prayer, or meditating on the word, it's been my place of comfort, encouragement, and a place to encounter God and his peace. Through worship, I was, and still am, rediscovering who God is, who he says he is, and getting to know him more as well as who I am in him. I was realizing that I'm not just an infertile woman struggling to get pregnant, but I'm the daughter of a king who created me, who loves me, who knows my heart, and who has sent his son to die for me. Finding my identity in Christ outside of our struggle really helped me to focus my eyes on Jesus and made me ready to learn what he was trying to teach me through infertility. So my weight doesn't just have to be going through struggles to make me stronger. It goes so much deeper than I ever knew. As I was seeking God, I started to ask questions. And at first, my questions were ones like, why me, God? Why do I have to suffer through my worst fear? Where are you? I was angry, bitter, sad, and depressed. It felt like my worst fear was coming true. I needed to find out more about his purpose for me and his purpose for this part of my life. The more I worshipped and praised him through my pain, and the more I got to know him and build my relationship with him, my questions began turning into ones like, God, where do you want me to go next? How can I worship you through this week? I was beginning to ask questions about how I could walk with him through it instead of fighting him on it. Those questions and hearing his answers was stirring up motivation and inspired me that I hadn't recognized. I had to learn more. About this time, my mom showed me a book called Wait and See by Wendy Pope. She wrote this book to help people that are waiting for something to find peace in God's pauses and plans. And it was through this study that I learned the most about myself and what God was teaching me. He spoke the loudest to me through this book, and I learned that there was more to do than just to wait. This brings us to I, investing in preparation. But what am I preparing for? How should I be preparing for it? Page 42 in the book says, too often we want a fast pass straight through God's pauses to move directly to his plan. God seldom hands out passes so that you can avoid the wait and skip to the front of the line. A rush through the wait has the potential to stunt our spiritual growth and dull our senses to what God wants us to learn as a result of our wait. He is actively working while we wait, a promise that never disappoints in the end. And just as the Apostle James tells us in chapter 1, verses 2 to 4, consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. So, I needed to wait for God to give me specific directions and then obey. Page 55 says, do what we know to do. Our inclination is to hurry to the finish line, when instead we should be patiently waiting to stay put. We should be patiently stay put, showing ourselves faithful. How? By doing what we know to do and responding to our Father with obedience, even if it means staying in our pasture. Why? Because it's in the pasture that God is preparing us for what is ahead. And then on page 55, it continues with, our job is not to run ahead of him or lag behind. We should take natural, common sense steps that are in line with his word, so we'll be ready when he delivers our heart's desire. So, as I wait, I will keep doing what I know to do and listening for his next steps. I will follow open doors and seek him when doors close. The last part of the acronym says to trust him and trust that he will fulfill his plans and promises. This is one of the biggest things that God has been teaching me and is still the hardest part of the wait. See, over the years, I thought I was at peace with God's plan, but I was trusting a plan that wasn't his. I was trusting that God was going to fulfill my plan for my future. This came time after time with people talking to me about the idea of fostering and asking me, what happens if you can't have kids? Will you guys adopt? I didn't even want to think about the fact that it's possible that God's plan doesn't involve me having my own biological kids. But I have to trust him, even if my dream doesn't come true. And that's the hard part. Finding peace with knowing that God's plan is better than anything I could imagine, and that he is good through it. Jeremiah 29:11 says, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. At about this part, or this point in my journey, came out about the same time that Mercy Me's song, Even If, came out. In the song it says, I know you're able, and I know you can, save through the fire with your mighty hand. But even if you don't, my hope is you alone. God, when you choose to leave mountains unmovable, give me the strength to be able to sing, it is well with my soul. The song just resonated with me, and it was a perfect worship outlet for me to trust that God is good, and that I'll be good, even if. So this is where I am now, in my wait. Still waiting, but I'm going to end with one more verse, and then I'd like to pray if that's okay. Isaiah 40:31 says, but those who hope and trust in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. It's been a long, difficult 5 years, but it's been an amazing opportunity for me to grow in my relationship with God and to know that he's got me. I'm looking forward to the day that I will be a mom, whatever that looks like. Let's pray. God, I am so thankful that you are who you say you are, that you are a powerful and able God, a faithful God, a merciful God, and that you have good plans for all your children. Lord, I know that there are many that are in a season of waiting, and I want to lift them up to you now. I pray, Father, that as they wait, they would know that you are moving and working in their lives and working to fulfill your promises for them. I pray that you would reveal to them what you'd like them to know, and that you'd guide them toward your plan. And God, if my wait or anyone else's wait never ends, that we would still hold true to your goodness and be able to say that it is well with our souls. Thank you, Father, for being our rock and for your unfailing love. Thank you that your ways are higher than ours, that you see what lies ahead, and that there's no place that we'll go that you've not already been. We love you, God, and it's in your name we pray. Amen.